Good evening. Welcome to another edition of Medicine in the News. I'm your host, Dr. Lee Radosh. Periodically, different organizations promote different awareness of different diseases, and February is Go Red for Heart Month, which is a time to consider heart disease, particularly in women, and to remind us that heart disease is the biggest killer of women. And tonight I have two experts that are on the show with us who recently are to the area, some cardiologists with Cardiology Associates of West Reading, and on a cold night especially, so thank you so much for coming out. So we have Dr. Aga Mochon and Dr. Olivera Gojkovic, again, both with Cardiology Associates of West Reading, and recently trained in Philadelphia, so we're talking about that. As always, if you have questions about this topic, our number is 610-378-0426. Again, 610-378-0426, and that number's on the screen. So again, thanks so much for coming out. And
thank you for having us.
You know, one thing, when people talk about heart disease, boy, there's so many things that that refers to. Can you give a general overview of the types of heart disease you see in your practice?
So heart disease is a very broad term, and it includes diseases of the heart muscle that can cause heart failure, diseases of the heart valves, abnormalities of the heart rhythm, and also abnormalities or disorders of the heart vessels, the vessels that are feeding the heart muscle.
Okay, so the four sort of broad categories, one where the heart isn't beating as well, that heart failure, where fluid can back up in the lungs, and many people are familiar with that. The heart valves, mm-hmm. the doors, so to speak, to the different parts of the heart, the rhythm, it could beat irregularly, and then the blood vessels. And a lot of times when people talk about heart disease, a lot of times we're talking about blood vessel disease. Can you tell me about what does that entail?
So you're right. People most commonly, when they talk about the heart disease, they mean coronary artery disease or blockages in the heart vessel. What it is a plaque buildup, plaque that is formed by fat and other substances that lays over in the vessel wall and gradually increases in thickness and eventually can either cause significant narrowing of the heart vessel, which then can present with symptoms of chest pain or shortness of breath, or if this plaque ruptures, can cause the heart attack.
Okay, so that's, again, when people refer to heart disease, a lot of times it's that blood vessel. And Olivera, what do people think of when they hear about heart disease, when you walk in the room to someone and tell them that they have heart disease? Are they surprised a lot, or are people aware of how common heart disease is in your experience?
I think most, it depends. I think most people are familiar with how common the heart disease is. I think there are probably women less so than men, and I think it's a general idea that heart disease, like we said, is just the heart blockages. And I think when you tell somebody, no, you have high blood pressure, that actually means a lot of people are surprised, okay, I have high blood pressure, and they don't necessarily mean that it is a part of the spectrum of heart disease or having atrial fibrillation or other conditions.
Okay, and so when we talk about different types of heart disease uh-huh. and the ones you mentioned, who is at risk? Like, who should be more in tune to some of these issues?
Okay, so when we talk about the risk of heart disease, we talk about different levels of risk, and there are three general groups, and depending on how the patient presents, they can either be in a high-risk group, and those are the people that already have either known heart disease or they have conditions that put them at a very high risk of having progressive heart disease, like patients with diabetes, patients with advanced kidney problems, patients that already have blockages in other vessels of the, you know, in the body, like their neck, the carotid, or the blood vessels in their legs, or in their abdomen, the aorta. So those are the people that are at probably have some blockages in their heart as well. Then on the other end of the spectrum, we have people that we consider to be at a very low risk, people that are what we call ideal risk. So people that eat well, exercise, don't smoke, they're not overweight, they don't have any family history of heart disease. So again, very small proportion of the patients. And then you have this big majority of the patients that are somewhere in the middle of that range, so that have one among or multiple risk factors, such as the ones I mentioned, the high blood pressure, the smoking, the high cholesterol, and those are probably the majority of the patients.
Right. And that you make a great point, because if someone's at very high risk, particularly someone who's already had heart problems or something else, they're probably or hopefully aware they're at risk. And then there's some people who are extremely low risk. But the challenge for us in medicine is that a lot of people are in the middle, and we have to figure out for whom should we be very aggressive and not. Mm-hmm. How do you tease that out when someone comes to you and says, hey, I've got this medical problem, should I take these medicines or not? What tools do you use, or how do you decide how aggressive to be with someone with risk factors and things like that?
So first of all, we talk to the patient. We ask them about their family history, and certainly if your mom or dad had a heart attack or stroke in an early age would put you at the higher risk of having heart attack or stroke in the future. And your doctor should be probably more aggressive when it comes to testing and prevention. We ask patients about their habits, their diet, exercise habits, smoking, very important. Everybody should not smoke, so smoking is an absolute no-no when it comes to prevention of heart disease. And then we, of course, examine the patient. So looking at the patient, patient's overweight, patient's obese, losing weight is the number one priority for these patients. Blood pressure, patients who have high blood pressure or borderline blood pressure, again, will be at a higher risk of the heart disease in the future. And then when you see patients in the office, when you come and see your primary care doctor, starting the age of 20, you should have your cholesterol check every 5 years. And your blood sugar with every routine blood work. And this is the first step to try to help us decide who will be very low risk versus this middle gray area.
So in terms of the risks you mentioned, you talked about family history, and I remember them in medical school, they used to say, boy, one of the best things you could do for your health is pick your parents if you could. But it's interesting that a lot of the risk factors you mentioned, high blood pressure, weight, smoking, are very controllable. I mean, right. Obviously hard to control, otherwise there wouldn't be, you know, billion-dollar industries,
right.
But it sounds like it's doable. What are some tips that you've found to help people get motivated to move them along? You see them in the office and they have high blood pressure and they're not keen on taking medicines or losing weight. What are some things you can do to help patients kind of move along with that?
I think it's really just showing them examples. I mean, there are multiple patients we had that are overweight. They have to see the results themselves. I feel like that's the only way for patients to really get motivated. Like if they lose, you know, they're actually work on losing weight, they're exercising, they lose 10 pounds, and all of a sudden they're taking one less blood pressure medicine or even diabetes, one less medicine for diabetes, and, you know, smoking. You know, I've had a couple patients where they quit smoking and all of a sudden, oh, I breathe a lot better. So I think it's really their more of their personal example, just motivating them to take that first step, and then afterwards it's sort of perpetuates itself.
And personalize it to show them the results, it sounds.
Right.
You know, we were talking a few minutes ago about blocked arteries and some of the heart diseases, and what people are very familiar with the term heart attack, and like you had said, mm-hmm. that's when these arteries, the blood vessels that take blood to the heart, can get blocked off. And if we could show a graphic for a moment and this kind of explain what we're talking about, and our viewers can see a picture. On one side of the screen is it looks like a straw, and with a little tiny hollow tube in the middle, and there's a section there, I'll try to bring up the arrow in a moment, but it talks about the warning signs of a heart attack: chest discomfort, discomfort in upper body, shortness of breath, cold sweats, nausea, lightheadedness, sort of the classic symptoms of a heart attack. But many people may be familiar with that, but one thing that we're taught, at least in medical school, is that sometimes heart attacks can present a little differently in women. Mm-hmm. And is that true in your experience? And if so, what can women in particular look for?
Chest pain is the most common sign of heart attack in women as well. Mm-hmm. I want women to remember, if you have a chest pain, not to think this is my heartburn, this is maybe a little bit of indigestion, or I strained my muscle, this still can be a heart attack, and this is the first thing they should think about. But women have more atypical symptoms, so they more frequently have shortness of breath, sweatiness, sometimes just fatigue, tiredness, just not feeling fine, something is not right, they cannot point at what exactly it is. it may be the sign of the coronary disease or significant heart problems. Cold sweats, nausea, vomiting. So all these atypical symptoms are more frequent in women than in men.
Yeah, they sound so nonspecific. It'd be certainly easy to miss and say to yourself, it's just I ate some bad fish the other day, if it's the nausea or cold sweats. Mm-hmm. In your experience, do you find that we in the medical community need to do a better job of catching women with those symptoms for heart disease? I mean, imagine we probably miss it sometimes. Mm-hmm.
So again, it comes to the risk factors. It doesn't matter if this is man or woman. If you have a patient who has significant risk factor of coronary disease or heart disease, you should think about it first, even though their symptoms are maybe not typical. Mm-hmm. And the very interesting thing is that on about 90% of women, they have at least one risk factors of the coronary artery disease or stroke, yet we are not very aggressive in prevention and screening in this woman, although they have, like I said, at least one risk factor, 90% of women. So if we look very carefully, we probably will be able to recognize it and find it. We just have to think about it.
Great. Mm-hmm. And I think we have a caller. Good evening and welcome to Medicine in the News.
Yes, thank you for taking my call. Yes, when I was going through the channels and everything, and I saw your program and women and heart attack, my mother, who is 96 years young, she is in great shape despite having dementia. But anyway, about 30 years ago, she had open heart surgery. And the doctors gave her about 5 to 6 years to live. And that was 30 years ago. Mm-hmm. She started walking. I started walking with her. And she's doing absolutely great. As far as a heart attack is concerned, question is, she didn't know she was having a heart attack until she was walking down the street and went to a knitting store where she goes, and the person takes a look at her. They said, "You look terrible." So they immediately contacted the doctor. They took her down to the doctor's office, and he said, took her blood pressure. And he says, "Well, I'm going to send you up to the hospital." At that time, the old hospital. And what happened was that they got her, and meanwhile, they drove her up to the hospital, and he called the hospital. And from then on, they had about 5, 6 doctors give her catheterization and everything else. But she is doing outstanding. And as far as heart disease is concerned, that's one thing that's in my family. And I know it's this woman, but also I'm going to be 65. And it was about that time my mother had a heart attack, and my grandfather, he had heart disease. And it's heart disease in my family. But one thing I'd like to ask, I'm 5'6". I just weighed myself about 188 pounds, okay? I think I'm eating too many donuts, and what is good healthy eating for heart, et cetera,
It's a good question, because one of the questions I wanted to ask about was diet. And first, you picked your parents well, as we were talking about, and it sounds like the store that your mother goes to, it sounds like they could have saved her life, which is wonderful, by recognizing that. Yeah. So thanks so much for the call, because one thing I did want to talk about is diet, because we're hearing more and more about the importance of diet, how processed foods and salts and sugar are contributing to this. Yet most of the cholesterol in our body, for example, our body makes. So what do you recommend to people with regard to diet and what they should do?
Well, in general, we always tell patients to eat a low-fat diet and low cholesterol, low salt diet. And it's really, I think it's hard for a lot of patients, especially patients we see that are older, that don't necessarily, you know, are either too ill to cook, or you know, just don't have the time, or they're living alone. So, and a lot of the salt is sort of hidden in the foods we buy in the store. So, well, we always tell the patients they have to read the labels, basically, and the limits in general is about 2 grams of salt, which is really not that much when you think about it. It's like maybe half of a teaspoon of salt, but that's really all we allow. And of course, you can never go wrong eating plenty of fruit, veggies, lean meats like chicken breast or fish. They're much better choices than eating beef or pork. Milk, of course, if it's whole milk, it's a lot worse than, you know, fat-free, you know, that kind of the cheeses. The snacks are terrible, you know, it's so...
So it's a lot of some of the themes there. It's mm-hmm. good points. A lot of it is sort of common sense.
Right.
But also the importance of reading the labels. Like you said, you may get something you think is healthy but has a lot of salt. Mm-hmm. So we have to be very aware of that. So, mm-hmm. so it's a great question. You know, one thing I wanted to ask as we're talking about Go Red for Heart Month, and there's some great information on the web at goredforwomen.org and the American Heart Association website about this, but there's so much emphasis both in terms of media campaigns, raising funds, awareness for breast cancer detection, and which is terrific. Yet so many more women are, you know, more directly affected in terms of, you know, true death and everything from heart mm-hmm. disease. So what can we do to sort of get the word out to let women know, hey, heart disease, you really need to think about that. What mm-hmm. can we do?
You're right. And breast cancer is a very serious health problem in women. But yet in there is about 1 in 31 American women that dies every year of breast cancer, and 1 in 3 American women that dies every year from heart disease. And I think we should just take an example from breast cancer campaigns. And it's great that our communities are so aware of breast cancer and early screening and prevention, and all women remember to get their mammograms. And we should talk more in our communities about heart disease and the importance of screening for heart disease. Like what we mentioned before, doctor visits, regular doctor visits, blood pressure check, cholesterol checks, with the patients with the significant history of family history of heart disease, women especially who have gestational diabetes or preeclampsia, so issues with blood sugar or blood pressure during the pregnancy.
So if they've had some of these complications in pregnancy, blood sugar issues in pregnancy or blood pressure, they even more so should get followed to make
absolutely,
sure.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I very frequently, these women see their OBGYN doctors and they kind of don't follow up regarding these issues. So Go Red for Women campaign, it's a great opportunity to make our communities more aware about the importance of heart disease in women.
Okay, and do you find that there are ways that we can get the word out to the medical community? Because sometimes, you know, I'm concerned that we, even in medicine, very well-intentioned, we'll see a woman for a checkup, for example, and say, oh, we need to get your mammogram, but the lipids may not be as on our mind. So what can we do to get us in the medical community moving forward?
It's a similar approach. So there's, especially in February, there is a lot of media attention, which is great to heart disease in women. There is a lot of internet websites like goredforwomen.org, which is a great resource not only for patients but also for physicians. And I guess it is make doctors aware, and this is the first stop. Once they remember about it, they're aware of it, they remember to talk to their patients about those issues.
Right, and if we could put up a graphic, because we have a list of some of the things that you talked about, and again, from this wonderful website from the American Heart Association, what can we do to lower risk? Mm-hmm. Eat a healthy diet, low in saturated fat, trans fat, cholesterol, and sodium. And I promise that Dr. Gojkovic didn't cheat. She didn't see the list ahead of time. But it, you know, certainly matches up there. Keep the weight under control, physically active, controlling the blood pressure, cholesterol, blood sugars, get medical checkups, talk about prevention plan, and as you had said, don't smoke, avoid tobacco smoke. So again, some of these are very doable, as they say, low-hanging fruit, and we really need to do a good job with some of them. You know, one thing I wanted to ask, too, in the short time we have left, you know, particularly because we're talking about heart disease in women, there was a lot of controversy years ago and still is regarding things like estrogen replacement therapies, things like that, and, you know, that's unique to women in terms of putting that. Where do we stand on that issue? Because years ago, it was all women should be on estrogen, then it wasn't, and where do we stand now?
So I guess the theory was that, you know, the younger women, estrogen is very protective, and this is why women in menopause tend to have a lot worse outcomes, more heart disease, because of one of the major reasons, the estrogen, because it's actually protective. So the theory was, okay, let's give some estrogen back and see, will that actually improve women's cardiovascular health and, you know, heart outcomes. And so they did this great big study, the Women's Health Initiative, back in 1990s, and they actually looked at that. They looked at what happens if we give women estrogen and progesterone, and they really sort of found the quite opposite, that, you know, those women actually had a little worse outcomes than women that were not taking hormonal replacement therapy, especially women that are more years out of menopause, like, okay, you know, women in their 70s tend to have a lot worse outcomes than women that even younger, if they're 50s and just starting taking estrogen. So in general, really, for cardiovascular protection, we definitely do not recommend hormone replacement. Now, of course, that doesn't mean if you have a woman that's with terrible osteoporosis, there's really no other way to treat a really terrible, exactly, lifestyle-limiting hot flashes. We don't say no to it, absolutely. It's just that those women do have to be monitored more closely.
Okay, so it sounds like we've found a balance, saying that we should not do it, put women on estrogen just to prevent heart disease. In fact, that's not the case. But if women really need to take it for other reasons, that's fine, but we just need to monitor. And of course, use common sense, be on it for as least amount of time as possible, and things like that, and monitor, which makes a lot of sense. We are just about out of time, but first I want to very much thank our guests for being on our show tonight. Again, Dr. Aga Mochon and Dr. Olivera Gojkovic from Cardiology Associates of West Reading. New to the area, well, fairly new. So, I just want to kind of recap what I'm hearing. Some of the messages you're saying is that that heart disease is incredibly common in women, and we need to be aware of it, and that women should get checked, just like men, and for heart disease risk factors, and that there's a lot we can do to help control and prevent heart disease, and that there's a lot of support in the community to do that with different specialists and generalists in the area who can do that. So again, on this cold winter night, thank you so much for coming in, and again, thank you so much for being with us this evening.
Thank you.